Harper Audio presents Small Town, written and read by Lawrence Block. On September 11th, 2001, sunrise came at 6:33 a.m. The forecast called for clear skies and a beautiful day. At 8:45 a.m., American Airlines Flight 11, bound from Boston to Los Angeles, struck the North Tower of the World Trade Center. At 9:05 a.m., United Airlines Flight 175, also bound from Boston to Los Angeles, struck the South Tower. At 9:50 a.m., 45 minutes after it had been hit, the South Tower fell. At 10:30 a.m., an hour and 25 minutes after it had been hit, the North Tower fell. At 10:29 a.m. on May 30th, 2002, cleanup efforts at Ground Zero were completed. There was widespread agreement throughout the city that nothing would ever be the same again. By the time Jerry Pankow was ready for breakfast, he'd already been to three bars and a whorehouse. It was, he discovered, a great opening line. Wherever he delivered it, in backroom bars or church basements, it got attention. Made him sound interesting, and wasn't that one of the reasons he'd come to New York? To lead an interesting life, certainly, and to make himself interesting to others. His next scheduled stop was in the Village, at Charles and Waverly. So he'd walked across 23rd and down 6th. That stretch of 6th Avenue had once afforded a good view of the Twin Towers, and now it showed you where they'd been, showed you the gap in the downtown skyline. A view of omission, he'd thought more than once. It was 10 o'clock, and he'd get to Maryland's by 11 and be out of there by 1, with the rest of the day free and clear. Maybe he'd catch the 2:30 meeting at Perry Street. He could stop by after he left Maryland's and put his keys on a chair so he'd have a seat when he came back at meeting time. You had to do that there. It was always standing room only by the time the meeting started. Recovery, he thought, the hottest ticket in town. 3 years sober, and he started each day by visiting three bars and a whorehouse, inhaling the reek of stale beer and rancid semen. The bars were in Chelsea, all within a few blocks of his top-floor walk-up on 17th west of 9th, and of course they were closed when he arrived for the morning cleanup. He had keys, and he would let himself in, trying not to dwell on the way the place stank, the odor of booze and bodies and various kinds of smoke, the dirty sock smell of amyl nitrate, and something else, some indefinable morning-after stench that was somehow more than the sum of its parts. He'd note that and dismiss it, and he'd sweep and mop the floor and clean the lavatories. God, human beings were disgusting. And finally, he'd take down the chairs from the tables and the stools from the bar top and set them up where they belonged. Then he'd lock up and off to the next. He hit the bars in what he thought of as working his way up from the depths, starting with Death Row, a leather bar west of 10th Avenue, with a back room where safe sex required not just condoms, but full-body armor. Then one called Cheek on 8th and 20th, with a neighborhood crowd that ran to preppy types and the aging queens who loved them. And finally, a straight bar on 23rd Street. Well, a mixed crowd, really, typical for the neighborhood. Straight and gay, male and female, young and old, the common denominator being an abiding thirst. The place was called Harrigan's, Harridan's, some called it, and it didn't reek of pot and poppers and nocturnal emissions, but that didn't mean a blind man might mistake it for the Brooklyn Botanical Gardens. In his drinking days, Jerry might have started the evening at Harrigan's. He could tell himself he was just stopping for a quick social drink before he settled in for the night. He wasn't cruising, certainly, because nobody went to a place like that trolling for a sexual partner. He supposed people who got drunk there sometimes went home with each other, but that was essentially beside the point. But after a few drinks there, and maybe a line or two in the men's room, a gay bar would seem like a good idea, and he'd be on his way to a place like Cheek. And there he might meet someone he'd take home or go home with, but he might not, and before the night was over, he could well wind up at Death Row or some equivalent thereof, barely knowing what he was doing or with whom he was doing it. And, when he woke up hours later, sickened by what he remembered or terrified of what he didn't remember, depending on just when the blackout curtain had dropped. Now he frequented the bars only in the morning to sweep and mop and straighten up, and on his way out he'd pick up the $20 left for him. the management of Death Row, perhaps overcompensating for the relentless squalor of the premises, tucked his payment into an envelope with his name on it. At Harrigan's and Cheek, they just left a $20 bill on the back bar, next to the register. Then the whorehouse, which took longer, but he was still in and out of the place in not much more than an hour, and his envelope, with Jerry and purple Pentel in a precise feminine hand, held $100. Always a single bill, and always a crisp new one, and, when you thought about it, an outrageous payment for the time it took. Then again, he sometimes thought, look what they got for a simple blowjob. Marilyn Fairchild's apartment was on the third floor of a four-story brownstone on Charles Street off Waverly Place, not a five-minute walk from Joe Jr.'s. The sky, overcast at daybreak, was clear now. It was the second week in June, and the weather had been glorious for the past several days. The entrance to Marilyn's brownstone was a half flight up from the street. He mounted the steps and rang her bell, gave her plenty of time to respond, then used his key. He took the steps two at a time. 3 years ago, bottoming out on drugs and alcohol, it was all he could do to drag himself up a flight of stairs, and baby, look at me now, and poked the buzzer alongside her door. He got the key ready, he carried more keys than a super these days, and rather liked the butch effect of it all, and when there was no response to his buzz, he let himself in. Place was a pigsty. Well, that was an exaggeration. It wasn't filthy. He cleaned for her once a week, and the apartment was never seriously dirty, but sometimes it was a mess, and it was certainly a god-awful disaster area this morning. Ashtrays overflowing with cigarette butts, some of them lipsticked, some of them not. A pair of rocks glasses, one holding a half inch of pale amber liquid, the other dry. The dry one showed lipstick, the other didn't. One of the cushions from the sofa was halfway across the room, and he wondered how that had happened. A pair of mahogany tables flanked the couch. Like the coffee table, they were from the Bombay Company, cheaply made but attractively styled. The table to the right of the sofa held three little figurines of animals, Zuni fetishes from the Southwest. There was a bison carved from Picasso marble, a rose quartz bear with a bundle of arrows on his back, and a turquoise rabbit, all of them grouped around the white saucer from a child's tea set. The saucer held cornmeal, except it didn't. Its contents had been spilled onto the table and floor, and the bison and bear were lying on their sides. And where was the little rabbit? With the cornmeal spilled, he thought, maybe the bear had gotten hungry enough to eat the rabbit. Failing that, he supposed he'd find it somewhere in the chaos of the apartment. Not for the first time, he contrasted Marilyn's place with the last premises he'd tidied, the whorehouse on East 28th Street. In all the months he'd been cleaning for them, they'd never once left a real mess. The place was always sanitary and usually neat. Well, wasn't that the difference between your professionals and your amateurs? He rolled his eyes, ashamed of himself. Marilyn was a sweetie, and where did he get off calling her a whore? Still, he could imagine her coming up with some version of the line on her own, a half smile on her full mouth, and an ironic edge to the bourbon and cigarette voice. Her self-deprecating sense of humor was one of the things he liked most about her, and, Jesus, was she home? Sleeping late, wasn't she? Well, she'd very likely been up late. He'd let her sleep, hold off running the vacuum until he was done with everything else. If that woke her, he could do the bedroom after she emerged from it. Otherwise, he'd skip it this week. She didn't have company, did she? He decided that wasn't too likely. The clothes in the living room were all hers, and the guy, whoever he might be, wouldn't have kept all his clothes on while she took everything off. Somewhere along the way, he'd returned from the bedroom, thoughtfully closing the door, and dressed and left the apartment, pulling the door shut. It hadn't been double-locked when he arrived, he recalled, but that didn't mean anything. Marilyn forgot to double-lock the door as often as not, whether she was at home or gone for the day. He'd met her at an adult Children of Alcoholics meeting, had heard her sharing wryly about her parents, and had assumed she was in show business. She looked the part. It wasn't that she was beautiful. Her features were a little too strong for beauty, her facial planes too angular. It was more that she was totally out there, her energy expanding to fill whatever room she was in. You noticed her, you paid attention to her. You couldn't buy that or learn it at Actor's Studio. You had it or you didn't, and she did. It's all my Leo stuff, she explained. I got my sun in three or four planets in Leo, and maybe I should have been an actress as much as I like being the center of attention, but I always had zero desire in that direction, and thank God, because what kind of a life is that? She'd been born in Brooklyn, grew up on Long Island, went to college in Pennsylvania, married young and divorced young, and had been living in the village for a dozen years, for the past 7 years, in this brownstone floor through on Charles Street. I had the usual array of jobs, and then I took a class at the Learning Annex, if you can believe it, and it was like I found my purpose in life. No time at all, I had my realtor's license and a job to go with it, and this place was maybe the fourth rental I ever showed. I took one look at it and saw it was rent-stabilized and what the price was, and no way was I going to let it go to some fucking client. So, of course, my first job was convincing this darling young couple that it was all wrong for them, and once I got rid of them, I put in an application and rented it to myself. I got fired for that, it's a major no-no, but who gave a shit? I had my dream apartment, and how long was it going to take me to get another job? 5 minutes? They'd stopped at a Starbucks after the meeting, and otherwise he might never have gotten to know her, because she never went back to ACOA. It was too humorless for her, she told him, and he could understand that, but suspected she also wanted to keep her distance from any program that might make her face up to her own relationship with alcohol, which he had to figure was at least somewhat problematical. She reined it in when she was with him, people often did in the presence of sober alcoholics, but one time she'd been a toke over the line, as it were, and he'd got to see the change in her eyes and in the cast of her features. Well, it was his job to clean her apartment, not to take her inventory. Someday he might see her at an AA meeting, and maybe she'd get sober and maybe she wouldn't, but for now her life seemed to work okay, or at least she thought it did. Though you wouldn't have guessed it from the state of her living room. Not this morning, anyway. And that was where he came in, wasn't it? He cleaned and straightened, washed glasses, emptied ashtrays, stuffed her dirty clothes in the bathroom hamper, put things where they belonged. He couldn't seem to find the turquoise rabbit. Maybe she'd taken it to bed with her, though animals carved from stone weren't really ideal for cuddling. But he put fresh cornmeal in the little saucer and positioned the bear and the bison on either side of it. He bagged the garbage, carried it downstairs, and stowed it in one of the trash cans in the rear courtyard. When he'd finished in the living room and kitchen and bathroom, and the small second bedroom she used for an office, he got out the vacuum cleaner and hesitated. He went to the bedroom door, put an ear to it, then turned the knob and eased it open. It was dark within, but enough light came through around the blackout shades for him to make out her form in the bed at the far end of the room. He said her name, Marilyn? To get her attention if she was just lying there half awake, but not loud enough to rouse her from a sound sleep. And she was evidently sleeping soundly because she didn't stir. Should he vacuum? It was that or quit for the day, leaving her bedroom untouched and the whole apartment unvacuumed. The noise might wake her, but she'd probably want to be up by now anyway, might even have appointments scheduled. He plugged in the old Hoover and had at it. If she slept through it, fine, it proved she really needed the sleep. If she woke up, even better. He remembered how delighted she'd been to learn what he did for a living. It's a get-well job, he'd explained, although it could be a career if I want. All I have to do is let it grow itself into an agency, a cleaning service. But that's too complicated for now. I like to keep it real simple. I make okay money and my rent's low and I get paid in cash and I'm done for the day and plenty of time to make an afternoon meeting. But a whorehouse, she said, how did that happen? The way it always does. You clean for one person and he recommends you to somebody else. She'd had more questions, and at the end she asked if he cleaned for any ordinary people. Like me, she said. He said, ordinary? And raised an eyebrow. And went on to say that he did indeed have a couple of private clients, no more than one a day, whose apartments he cleaned once a week. By the time they left the coffee shop, they'd arranged that she would be one of them. I wonder, she'd said, do you think I could ever take a turn at your whorehouse? You mean like Belle de Jour? Sort of, except I have a hunch it works better if you look like Catherine Deneuve. Anyway, I'm probably too old. You're what, 38? You're only 38 and could pass for 29, is what you meant to say, isn't it? Word for word. 38's not old. How old are the girls in your whorehouse? It's not my whorehouse, and I don't have any idea how old they are. There's nobody home when I do my thing. Men want young girls, don't they, in a place like that? I have no idea what men want, he said archly, in a place like that or anywhere else. What's this all about? You wouldn't really want to do it, would you? Probably not, but it's an awfully nice fantasy. Well, enjoy yourself, he said. There's no age limit in fantasies. The vacuuming didn't wake her. Neither did the phone. He stood still for a moment, frowning. But really now, couldn't he just pack up and go? He'd cleaned everything but the bedroom, cleaned really quite thoroughly, and he couldn't do any more without disturbing her sleep. If she was asleep. He paused at her bedroom door, took a deep breath, let it out, took another. He opened the door, let his eyes accustom themselves to the dimness. There she was, just as he'd seen her earlier. Sprawled out on her bed, obviously in deep slumber. It looked as though she hadn't stirred since he'd first looked in on her. Room had an odor. Nothing too rank, but even if he was going to let her sleep, he ought to open a window. Hard to sort out the smells. Sex, booze, cigarette smoke. He walked over to the side of the bed, looked down at her. She was on her back, her head to one side.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.